human industry generally.
For a very long time, people have noticed the similarities between economic systems and biological systems, and particularly the notion of competition in both systems. When businesses compete, we can think of them as design. So you might have a design for a bank, a way to run a bank. And each of the banks along the high street will have a slightly different way of running a bank, a different design. And the evolutionary competition is it's a competition for you walking down the high street to determine which bank will serve you best, which design suits your needs better than the others.
So are we looking at corporate apes fighting for supremacy without compassion, teeth bared? I wonder if it's more posturing than reality.
Do you think there's a risk of overdoing the Darwinian analogy?
Yes, very much so. The press loves to play up company CEOs and entrepreneurs as these heroes, and in many ways they are. They work incredibly hard, make great sacrifices. But the myth is that they were these great visionaries, these people who could predict the future and drive an organization toward that future. The reality is economic systems, just like biological systems, are hugely complex. And being able to predict what's going to happen in the long term is extraordinarily difficult or even impossible. And what some companies do is, rather than try to outguess where the market is going, they'll create some notion of variety within their company and then let the market choose, let customers decide which products and services they like best.
So yeah. These legendary moguls who emerge, I mean, is it sort of luck that they're the ones who just, they just happen to get it right, and with hindsight you can say that they got it right, but that's all, it's just hindsight.
Well, not to take away from the talent that these individuals may have, but if you imagine a room full of people flipping coins, if the room's big enough, one of them is going to get 10 heads in a row. And then if you ask that person, what did you do? They'll say, well, I'm an expert coin flipper, I got my wrist just right. And we see the same thing in business.
So Darwinism in business seems to be little more than a metaphor, an analogy. It certainly doesn't provide a straightforward natural law for economic progress, as social Darwinists used to argue. But can Darwinism be applied to other areas of human affairs? What about taking back the reins of our own evolution? Don't copy nature, but control it. Speed up the elimination process.
Once they have been born, defectives are happier and more useful in these institutions than when at large. But it would have been better by far if they had never been born.
It's been tried before. The eugenics movement of the early 20th century aimed to stop the weak procreating through compulsory sterilization of the unfit.
Eugenics seeks to apply the known laws of heredity so as to prevent the degeneration of the race and improve its inborn qualities.
Here was a slippery slope down to a nightmare. At its worst, eugenics became a dark tribal vision, ultimately used to justify ethnic genocide in Nazi Germany. Eugenics is not a version of natural selection. Hitler, despite popular legend, was not a Darwinist. Every farmer, horticulturalist, or pigeon fancier knew how to breed for desired outcomes. Eugenicists like Hitler borrowed from breeders. What Darwin uniquely realized was that nature can play the role of breeder. Darwin has been wrongly tainted. I've always hated how Darwin is wheeled out to justify cutthroat business competition, racism, and right-wing politics. And throughout my career, I've grappled with the apparent paradox of the way cooperation, being nice to each other, even morality, could evolve from the mindless brutality of nature. Charles Darwin argued in Origin of Species that evolution of life on Earth had been driven by a brutal struggle for existence. Natural selection can seem bleak for many biologists. Certainly, nature can be pitiless and cruel. But I've been intrigued by what appear to be acts of kindness in nature. warning cries, huddling for warmth and comfort, and mutual grooming. Animals like these are displaying what we call altruism. They're giving something to another at a cost to themselves. The question I've grappled with as a biologist is why? The explanation must at some point involve the brain. Altruism, like any other behavior, must have evolved over time as brains have evolved. So now, I want to talk to somebody who knows about our evolved psychology.
Steve, hello, nice to see you.
When we teach about evolution, we naturally tend to focus on anatomy, but you could equally well say that psychology, that our minds are evolved organs or organ systems, couldn't you?
Well, yes, and we have every reason to believe that the mind is a product of the activity of the brain, and I happen to have one here. And it's clear. The brain is an organ. It's got an evolutionary history. All of the parts in the human brain you can find in the brain of a chimpanzee and other mammals. And we also know that the brain is not just a random neural network. And we have reason to believe that a lot of the products of the brain, our perception, our emotions, our language, our ways of thinking, are strategies for negotiating the world, surviving, bringing up children, finding mates, negotiating relationships.
I suppose we can all understand why sexual lust has a Darwinian survival value. And are you now saying that the mechanisms for guilt, trust, that those are a bit like lusts? I mean, there's a lust to trust, or yes. Is that not a...
Indeed. I mean, there are... and people have no problem accepting Darwinian explanations for emotions that are triggered by the physical world. Fear of heights and snakes and spiders and the dark and deep water. Disgust at bodily secretions that might be carrying parasites or rotting meat and so on. Often feel a little more surprised and even resistant to the idea that some of our moral emotions might have an evolutionary basis, like trust, like sympathy, like gratitude. But I think that as clear as it is that fear has an evolutionary basis, I think our moral emotions can be analyzed in the same way.
I think Steven Pinker is right and that we do have an evolved morality. But I also understand why there is resistance to the idea. Why would the genes for the parts of the brain that involve giving at a cost to oneself be inherited in nature's brutal struggle for existence? Darwin defined this as sexual selection. Evolution, he now realized, wasn't just about which animals survived, but which could prevail in winning the favors of the opposite sex.
Cowboy, keep an ear real for you. I'm the naked cowboy. You gotta do what you gotta do.
There are two ways for an individual to pass its genes on to the next generation. You've got to survive, and you may have to be attractive to the opposite sex. A peacock is a walking advertising hoarding. A peacock's tail, with its eye spots, is like a walking neon sign.
Here in America, I'm looking into an unexpected way in which women could be said to be practicing a form of selective